Greetings, chat. No, wait a second, that's not right. Welcome back to Chance for Paradise. So you can see that I cleared this room. I had to do a lot of experimentation off camera, but I found that I was actually on the right track. I needed to spot a couple of moves. So, due to the format of this room, where I kind of solved part of it one way and part of it another way on, like, several different episodes, I'm just going to take a look at the victory demo and show you how to do this room from start to finish. And hopefully that'll be a lot better than just starting it midway through and saying, well, okay, here's how you do this last part, and for the earlier parts, consult this earlier video. So, here we go. So the start is pretty much the same as it was in earlier times, because I didn't have to change that at all. We're still doing these regular old plus-shape movements that you could have seen in the earlier rooms. Again, transformations to other Tetris pieces may be necessary in order to move around some of these pits, but this is all pretty standard. Getting to the center is not hard, even in this room. So there's a little bit of fumbling around, but a little bit of persistence, we're going to get to this part, where we're trying to break into the northwest corner. So this is where I was making those shapes that were a little bit stranger than the Tetris shapes earlier. You can see I'm separating out a little bit of space, but eventually I'm working my way into that northwest corner there. Yeah, I mean, it takes me a little bit of fiddling around to get there, but yeah, I think I leave that space there, and then I... yeah, and then I make that push. That's what lets me free up this tile and this tile at the same time. I want, like, this tile just below these two pits squares here, and I want the tile that's diagonally adjacent to the interior corner here. I wanted both of those free. So I get that. Then I push that, and then I push that over there, and I can turn that into this shape. Well, and then I kind of have to backtrack a little bit, but yeah, then I do that. And that gets me, again, a very similar shape where, again, those two are free, but I've actually got this pit square free. And because of this L shape, I can actually proceed from here, like so. Well, okay, maybe not that way, but yeah, maybe this way. Yeah, that way. Now I've got this shape, which is even better, because now I can actually get that, that something out of there. I can make that. Right, so that's how I got into the northwest corner in the first place, and that, and, you know, I can bump that, move that over, do that. Right, so that's how I got here. And then I wasn't sure how to proceed, but then I figured it out. And, you know, I think that took me about half an hour, so, I mean, that would have been, like, the better part of the whole video all by itself. But yeah, you just do that, and now you have this S shape, but in order to get back out, yeah, now you can drag that back over, and now you have the same shape again that we've seen earlier, this kind of, I'm not sure what to call it, I guess you could call it an N, maybe? But in this case, I can step over here, and I can push this back, and that gives me just enough space to actually recover out of there, as you see, once I figure that out. Yeah, there we go. This looks a little bit tricky, but in fact, it's not really any harder than the earlier parts, because now I can just make these kinds of adjusting moves. Right, and now we're back to this part. And now that I've, you know, pushed this sun thing over here, now everything's all free, and I'm pretty much in the center area again. So then I just do a little bit more fiddling around that is pretty much along the same lines, pretty standard movement. And then I just make my way over to the southeast corner, which is not hard. And then I hit that plate, and then I get back out. So then I have to do a little bit of fiddling around just to make sure I don't accidentally push a sun thing out this passageway, which would be bad, but again, that's not that any more complicated than anything else I've done in this room. If you made it this far, that won't be hard at all, and you kill all the sun things. Alright, so that's how you do it, and that's from start to finish. Now, I would of course, again, want to optimize my routing. So I also happen to have one extra lead that I can follow up on so that this episode doesn't just contain, like, 3 minutes of me working out that room and then just, like, half an hour of wandering around. No, this is going to be wandering around with a point, with a purpose. It's going to be wandering towards a destination that we all have in mind. So we're going to get out of there. There's nothing else left to do here. I want to hit a checkpoint at some point. Well, let's see. There is not a checkpoint in this room. I kind of expect there to be. Anyway, so I'll just get to it. I guess I can do it now. So in the restore screen, as long as I don't actually restore anywhere, I'll be fine. I actually looked at town. I was looking at all these, you know, puzzle levels, you know, just making sure they were all explored. But one thing I kind of glossed over is town is not fully explored, and it has a secret in it. So I actually need to explore towns. So that is exactly what I will do. And of course, the obvious thing to do is to look around some of here, see if there's a secret wall that goes to another level. I guess it's probably not in here. But you never know. Is there anything in the sacred forest? Doesn't look like there's any kind of secret way out. Sadly, none of these NPCs are going to be giving me any hints because, they don't have any more dialogue. I guess I've kind of exhausted everything that there is to do in town. So it's just a matter of looking for more stuff. This is a nice little, kind of... I don't even know what this is. This is like a... I guess it's just like a plinth that you stand on and address the town or something. But I don't know why it's all the way over here. I don't think there's a secret wall up here. This would be a really sneaky way to hide one, but I guess not. Maybe this is another one of those secrets that you come into from another level. I mean, that would be a little bit awkward. I think I already poked around in here, and I was, like, absolutely sure there was no secrets in here, but I have to double-check anyway, just because you have to be exhaustive about these things. Oh, well, hold on, hold the phone. Okay. I guess I missed that all this time. Insanity, you say? I already handled insanity. I mean, what was it? It was fluff, but, wasn't the, sewers insanity as well? So really, this shouldn't be any more difficult than the rest of the hold, I mean. Alright. Only one way to find out.
Have you ever wondered if there was something like a shining gem that has never been seen or touched by somebody before? Something that has not been dirtied by anyone's greasy, gross hands? Do you think there is a place where we can nap or be at peace without worry of what the scary future has in store for us? What if you could go to this place, even if it was just for a teensy-weensy moment? Well... I dream of being able to live in such a place, along with falling in love with a prince, getting married, having a beautiful dress, and having an unlimited supply of orange juice. I like to take lots of naps and cuddle with my Gentry Eye plushies because it's so cute.
Well, I have to say, I was pretty impressed with that delivery. I mean, I gotta admit, having unlimited orange juice would be pretty mean. What's going on here? We need to... Well, there's some water here, so I guess I'd want to put some ice in it or something. Is this a custom music track? I think it is. Fortunately, I think these fluffs might be in the wrong group in order to get them to form up properly. Yeah, I don't think I'm going to be able to get them into a cloud. So what do these crystals do? They're just obstacles. That's what the obstacles in this tile set looks like. So if it is fluff forming, then is it just a movement order thing? Yeah, alright. Well, if that's what we're going to be doing today, then that's what we're going to be doing today. Alright. This is good advice in general, especially if you're just trying to do this, like, with the four separate puffs, you really do need to pay attention to movement order. Otherwise, you're just gonna have troubles. So, in this case, obviously our one-by-one passageways at the end of this are just set up to make our life miserable. So what we want to do is make, like, some kind of movement like this, and then kind of flatten it out like that. And, of course, have them all join up together. Now, what are your... Do you move first? Is that actually going to work? No, it's not going to work, because fluff only forms, like the big old fluff clouds only form at the end of the move. So everybody has to take their movement before a cloud can form. So we're going to have to kind of reshuffle these a little bit. Let's see here. Like, that's sort of right. How's our movement order looking? Yeah, this one's moving first. So that's not going to quite work out. But it's sort of the right idea. I mean, this is actually, we did something really similar in the Sacred Forest, I think. If I remember right. So, this shouldn't be out of the ordinary. It's kind of weird that this is next to the volcano, though. When you really think about it. Yeah, that's not going to work either. So let's start again from the beginning, because I clearly have not made any particular progress. Not that the starting movement order matters all that much, but it's still worth taking note of. But yeah, I think we want to start at this end and then kind of try and wrap our way around as best we can, because we can circumnavigate this diamond a lot faster than we puffs themselves can. But yeah, anytime you get them separated out into like a set of three like this, like it's in three rows, you're never gonna get your fluff. So we want to like turn it around so that it's actually like this, sort of. Well, that was almost right, except that this one fell behind. Like you can make these things work such that it all kind of goes into formation, but again, it's kind of hard to see that ahead of time. Just because of the way these things are set up. Maybe that's sort of good. It can kind of wrap around like that and then make it work somehow. Well, okay, actually that could help. Well, it would help if it was actually correct, but other than that, it was pretty good. Alright, can they just fold together like this? Are these guys going to move first? No, of course not. This number one's over here. I've seen situations like this where, like, this one on the outside, this one on the outside move first. They just go ahead and move in and they block these two, and then that works. But, unfortunately, we don't quite have that either. Alright, let's see what happened here, just to make sure that we understand. That moved first, that makes sense. This one just gets blocked by the first one, that makes sense. And then these two come in. So there actually isn't that much movement order going on here at all. Well, other than the fact that this one moves first. That's the only thing that actually matters in this particular L-shaped formation. This one moves first. After that, it doesn't matter what order any of these other three move in. Just that this one moves first. So that's actually good to know. I should remember that for later. Alright, well, how are we going to proceed from here? Six fluffs? Seven? Or just four with obstacles? Okay, I can accept that. So we've got our friend, the two-tile gentry eye, and we need to make fluff. All of the places I see to make fluff are adjacent to the gentry eye's reach. Okay, that's good to know. So I need to track everybody to one side and then do similar strategies to what we did before by running away to the other side. And hopefully we can just get them all to conglomerate together. Of course, the gentry eye is going to eat any puffs it tries to eat. In fact, if puffs move into the gentry eye, it'll also just disappear. Like so. Now this appears to be just completely symmetric, yeah. It's rotationally as well as, horizontally and vertically symmetric. So there's nothing weird going on here. You know, other than the fact that these crystals are apparently growing into the walls, which is kind of scaring me a little bit. But, not much we can do about that. So, yeah, I think by the time, like, I want it to already be formed by the time this is all up. So let's go back here. We probably want a very specific movement order for this point. This is a good point to start our analysis from. If we could somehow, like, alright, so let's start here, give ourselves a maximum amount of time, and go over here. What does it look like from here? Alright, this is close to being fine. We might be able to make this work somehow. Like, ideally what I would want is for, this pair to already be over here or something. Or, here and here. How would I make that happen? Well, I could make that happen by putting two down here. And then putting the rest up there, somehow, I think. Alright. Would this do anything? I'd want this to move first and this to move second, so that both of them could slide up into here naturally. And then I think the combination of them going up into here and these starting over here might combine into a puff when I go around counterclockwise like this and go over here. That's the idea I've got right now as far as movement is concerned. And I just need to shuffle these around a little bit so I can actually get that going. Alright, what does this look like now? That's bad. That's what I want. Okay, let's see if my hypothesis is correct. So we're gonna wait. We're gonna go over here. Right, so now that that's gonna go... This one moved first, so it went into there, and this one moved vertical preference style, so go in there. Okay, so now if the movement order is correct, hopefully all three of these will move before this one. That one is number 5, so yeah, I think I should have this now. There we go. So again, the only thing that mattered here was that, both of those. I wanted this condition where I got both of them to slide up into here, and I wanted this one to move last. So there's a bit of freedom with movement order. I didn't specifically have to get all four puffs into a specific movement order out of the 24 that were possible. I really only had two constraints, so it wasn't too bad. Still, I had to actually envision that that would work, so that's okay. Oh, so now I have a choice. Alright, I guess I'll go south. Are we constraining ourselves to just four puffs here? Well, I guess that's fine. I wouldn't want to make anything larger. What's this? Just this citizen that's going to turn on and off these fire traps, of course. These things weren't hazardous enough yet. Oh, no, that's a problem. Okay, so I have just enough time to do that. I don't know how well this is timed, actually. I should probably count it. But I guess that's okay. So it seems like there's a pretty obvious area where we want to gather everybody. Yeah, this is not actually timed to the puff cycle, in fact. Okay, yeah, this is gonna be weird. Yeah, I'm not sure I can actually fit everybody. It's gonna be really specific, actually. Yeah, this is gonna be really weird. Even from this point, to get this last puff out, what did this look like, actually? Well, in this case, the one that moves first is always going to be here, because it's another bottleneck. So the one that moves first is going to be like this, and we're never going to have, one up here and one in here. So we're not going to be able to get them both in one cycle. So it's always going to look something like this. So, we could have, one in here and one over there, but that would just be worse. I think this is the best intermediate point we can have. So what's this going to look like? Press it for two turns. Honestly, I'm a little bit iffy about the use of a citizen for a timer here. I'm pretty sure you could use a snake, and it would be a little bit more obvious what turns this is pressed for and what turns it's not. Or I guess you could use a brain roach that was on a loop or something. That would also work. Anyway. So I'm just trying to envision what's going to go on here, of course. So it seems like, once again, we're going to want some kind of helpful movement order to take place. I'm not sure this is actually going to work out that well. So I'm not sure if... can I actually make it here in time? I'm going to try going around the west side. I'm not sure if going around the west side will actually work, but it's worth a try. Sort of might. It might work. It would work if all three of these were in the perfect movement order, and all three of them moved up, and then they would all move before this is pressed. And it would have to be a this would have to be on a turn. Like, this would have to be on a five. Okay, so just taking a look at the movement order again, it's pretty clear that my strategy is actually, it could work in principle, if I could just swap the order of these two puffs, which would mean I'd have to do a little bit more preparatory work here. But it's theoretically possible that if I had, I would still be able to do exactly the same steps leading up to this. I would still be able to achieve this formation if I had the puffs in the order of four down here, three in here, and two over here. Simply because, again, three would be over here and four would be here, so three would slide over this way. Two would come up here, and four would go down here. I did that in the wrong order, but you get the idea. They would still split up in the correct way, such that this puff went over here, instead of having a diagonal formation of this one over here and that one over there, which wouldn't work out. Then, once all the puffs were in that order, then I would be able to go up the west side like I did earlier, which would get all three of them to survive this fire trap in the corner. And then I could bring this final one down, probably, and maybe form it, like, over here or something. I don't know. But in any case, I think I need to restart so I can actually get that. But now that I know what movement order I'm working towards, I can probably get to it. Alright, so what do we start with? We start with number 2 and number 4 over here, and number 3 and number 5 over here, naturally, of course. In fact, yeah, I need to wait a little bit, because I need them to resync up with this thing. The fact that this thing isn't on a, like, this is not a multiple of five down here, that's both good and bad. As far as, like, I mean, architecturally, it's a good idea. As far as just setting up tactics over here in view of the player, it just means that I have to pay attention to what point of the cycle it's kind of aligned to. Which is interesting. I mean, I guess it's, like, slightly more interesting than what it would be if it was just always the same offset, but it just means that there's more to pay attention to. There's more overhead if you get the gist. Alright, so... So that's all the same. Well, okay, well, it's not all the same because this one's dying here, because they formed in that order, naturally. Is there anything I can do about that? Sort of? Well, no, not really. No, there's nothing being done about fixing that. So I guess I want to come off the other side then. Are these in the correct order? First. So I'm going to have to just be faster. I need to fit in more moves. Yeah, I need to just realign it with this thing so I can have more time. One more, maybe? Yeah, there we go. So now I can move it on the exact turn that it comes off. And, again, that would either be possible or impossible, depending on, again, if this were a multiple of five and offset in a particular way. But because it's not tied to the clock like that, I can just take as long as I want. And, no, I'm not going to get one more. I am three short. Okay, so... Even with perfect timing, I'm still, yeah, so this method won't work. I got out of this in a particular way earlier. There must be a smarter way to do this, because, you know, I didn't get stuck in the star at the start. Well, let's see. No, there's no way to affect it at the start. It's just always going to look like that. Like, maybe I could space them out like that, and then maybe that helps. Yeah, I guess I could see that. Okay. No, that's still not actually right. I mean, that'll just kill it immediately. Yeah, well, apparently I should have saved a demo, because apparently that part was hard, and I just didn't notice. Let's see. Maybe I can restore up here. Because now I just really need to know. Apparently I need this for reference. Let's just see how we did the first part. So we can do it consistently. Okay, apparently I just went for it. So let's see. Went there. Yeah, then I went down, and then I went all the way around before I could actually even move down. Okay, that makes sense. Alright, I can get behind that. Let's back up a bit. So what movement order are these in? This is 5, and that's 3. So I'm going to get 3 through here, and then 2 and 4 already like that. Okay. So I can make this happen. Or I could send 5 through like that. That's another option. Then I would have, like, 2, 4, and 5 down here. That could actually work. You know, that tickles my fancy. Let's try that one. Let's let that one catch up. How's that going to look? It's going to look like 4 down here, 2 up there, and 5 up here, actually, when I want 5 to be down here, because I want, like, 5, 4, 2. Yeah, 5 down here, 4 over here, 2 up there. So that's actually probably more trouble than it's worth. Because, let's see here, the 2 is... Yeah, actually, the 2 is just going to want to kind of tend to go down this way, unless I, like, bring it up here. So, I probably want the 3 to come through after all that. That's probably less of a headache, then. Alright, so 3 goes through now, and 5 will stay there. And hopefully that makes setup a little bit easier. So I think what I'm going to have to do is bring the 2 and the 4 up in here. I'm gonna need to do this earlier. Like, I could just do this. That's fine. That works. And then 4 will go down, and then 2 will go down. Yeah, that makes sense. Sort of. Well, actually, does it, though? No, I need these to switch places. Okay, I think I can make that happen. Like, so now I've made 2 be on the west side here, 3 over here, and 4 over there. And that should actually help me. So now I should be able to sneak over here. This offset will cause the 2 to be up here, and this will actually get what I want done. I'm keeping in mind that this one is getting dangerously close to over here, but hopefully I'll be able to fix that. I should be able to fix that automatically as I go up the west side, hopefully. So that's going to deactivate, that should reactivate, and that one's actually pretty close to dying, but hopefully I can... Well, yeah, maybe I can just make a run for it. It'll be here, then here, run, 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 and no, that's not fast enough at all. Okay. So how am I going to fix that, then? Well, one way I could do that would be, have this already be up in this passageway. Like, sure, I could probably do that. Then it'll pretty much just be stuck while, working on all this other stuff. And that would be fine with me. Let's see. So yeah, that happens. I still need to swap this one and this one, but as I showed, that shouldn't be too hard. So that gets the 2 down there, and then the time that, but that's okay. I'll get it. So, just one more cycle. I'll just wait. If that's the case, then I need to wait a little while I time this. So, maybe 2 puff movements should do it. that's just here, so I need to wait a little bit. So there, then that, then... No. I don't think it's this... Well, yeah, actually it is that 5. That 5 is a gray, in fact. So yeah, I need to... I'm just going to need to wait up top of it. Like, I think that's the right idea. I think that's going to fix my problem, is putting the 5 up in this passageway while I'm fiddling around with this stuff, because then it'll just be trapped up here while I'm moving these 3 around. Then I should be able to fix everything, but it just makes the micromanagement of this northeast corner a little bit harder. But I think I'll get there. I just need to wait a little bit so I can actually properly resynchronize the timer, which is unfortunately a little bit annoying, but... There's only so much I can do about it. Actually, what I should be doing is I should be waiting, like, over here. So at least, like, this starts sufficiently further away from this thing that I can actually get my work done over here. So go down here, then over here, then... I was one short. Does that work? Yeah, actually that does work. Yeah, that gets me the one I need, because this goes down. That should give me just enough time to run up that. That was probably on purpose. Yes, and now this one's up here. Good. So I don't think I need any special timing for this part. That'll just happen, and good. This is what I wanted. 2, 3, 4. Now I should be able to get this done once I retime this properly again. Run up. And, yeah, what I would want is for it to be on a perfect 5 movement here. So that I could go up this way. And bring them all up and out of this fire trap. That sounds very possible to me. It's just that I don't know what value the timer allows them. But this is the best value of the timer, so there must be something else I'm missing. I mean, obviously that's not going to help. So I move there immediately. The best possible turn. And then I'm 3 short. So, okay, so that just doesn't work then. Okay, well then there must be something else I can do then. I thought I was on the right track, but apparently I'm not. Like, if I could go up into this middle passageway again, then that would just be great, but there's no such luck this time. Okay. Well, I know that you can form fluff on top of these fire traps, as long as you do it quickly. I don't know how I would do that, though. Like, let's see here. Yeah, so if I simply can't do it this way, then what other way is there? I'm going to assume that, there's nothing in particular that's special about the east side. I just did it because some of these were already in the correct movement. There's nothing special about the east side versus the west side. They're just the same thing. I can't get the fluffs out. And I don't have a pushing implement anyway, and this is way too wide, so no, there's no breaking the puzzle that way. That's not what I'm expected to do. I'm just expected to make fluff either here or here, equivalently, here or here. I don't know, what happens if I go here? Well, nothing good, I'm assuming, because now there's just fire traps here and here. You know, there's no way anything good is going to come from that. I mean, it's good that this is the shorter side. Well, hold on. Maybe I can actually make this work. What if I run all the way up here? Well, no, that's not going to help. Even if it did, like, even if I could get them to move immediately, which they're not going to, I don't have enough time for that. Even if I did, they'd still just be arranged in, like, a very same or very similar way that's just not going to help. So my mistake must have been made earlier. Like, is there a way to actually survive this part, then? Like, could I get all 4 of them down all in one motion? I mean, that's not... that's just way too slow. But, is there anything smarter I can do from this position? Or is this position too strong? Like, ideally, I would want, like, three in here and one up there. And I'm pretty sure I could make that work somehow. Or could I? Maybe I couldn't. Yeah, I don't know. This one's strange. But I think I'm just going to go ahead and save a demo of what I've got so far. And I'm going to try the other room. Maybe that'll give me more of an insight as to what I'm supposed to do here. Because I think I'm sort of... Like, I thought I was on the right track, and I clearly wasn't. So there must be something else that can be done here with, like, a different puff feeding in order. Some way to temporarily catch the puffs in, like, a really idiosyncratic, like, spacing out that avoids fire traps or something. But clearly the clever strategy that I thought of was not actually all that clever, so probably good to just retreat and come back. So I don't get quite so fixated on that one strategy. Alright, what have we here? Okay, it's our good friend the Mimic. I like Mimics. They are usually very educational. Okay, there's a thin ice here. And indeed, there's some puffs. So now they're going to be attracted to the Mimic, because that's how that works. And how do we get in here? We actually get in here from over there. So actually, we're going north. Okay. Fair enough. Alright, so what's this room? This room has nothing in it. It's just a blue door. Okay, I can accept that. Okay, and so this path leads over to the other room, and this is this room. Okay. Well, I already took a look at the Mimic room, so, like I said, I like Mimics. So let's do the Mimic. So that opens all that and closes this. We have a very weird and, once again, idiosyncratic. That's just the particular word to use for this situation. A very particular space for Beethro. In fact, it's actually not that much larger than the things itself. So we have these obstacles in here, so I don't think it matters what direction I step onto this plate from. Like, each of them gives a particular offset of Beethro compared to the Mimic, but because there's so many obstacles in here, I think I could just make it work. So I think this is just, like, these hallways are just here to be annoying and to prevent moving eastward particularly quickly or something. Okay. So, the only place that you can form a, again, your 2x2 fluff is over the middle here with this water space. Nowhere else will work because of the presence of these obstacles. So, let's get to it. Of course, we can't move the Mimic particularly quickly, but that hopefully shouldn't be too much of a problem. It's going to get a little claustrophobic, though, in a second. Yeah, like once they crowd you, there's nowhere to push it off of again, which is important. I mean, that's good to know. Yeah, you always need to be able to return to the center to go horizontally. That's really the main thing. Going vertically is easy, going horizontally is hard. And you need to go horizontally in order to kind of move around these obstacles anyway. So yeah, whatever movement you make, it better be a quick one. Otherwise the fluffs are just gonna crowd your guy. Now, another option, actually, that I shouldn't completely discount is there's no particular reason the Mimic has to remain alive, right? Because it can die, and then the puffs can start moving towards Beethro, and if they do make a fluff, maybe that could end up being important. Like, we shouldn't just immediately assume it's a failure condition just because the Mimic dies. Sometimes Mimics are supposed to die. And as brutal as that may seem, I mean that's the way of nature. Sometimes your Mimics, you know, they've lived a glorious life, and actually that is a failure condition because one of the puffs is going to disappear. Okay, and there's no other way to kill the Mimic in here. Yeah, there's no hot tiles or anything. So, yeah, actually, they're just going to have to form a fluff while the mimic is still alive. Okay, very well then. Still good to figure that out. So what else can I do then? Maybe I actually want to start that way. Maybe starting offset is important. I feel like dragging them down here is good, because that kind of forms a horizontal offset. I mean, it means that I can move the mimic around vertically and still manipulate the puffs to some extent. So then I would want to, like, move it, like, well, not like that, even. Let's see here. I mean, that's a thing. They're kind of moving in pairs. I can't really block any of them with my sword. So, yeah, actually from this position, I would want to take these puffs and then, like, put the mimic all the way up there. Which is only possible if, like, I can do some particular kinds of pushing movements. Let's see, so, yeah, I actually want, like, the mimic to be, like, one square even more down, if that's even possible. And I already picked that option. Alright, well, I already set up that zigzag formation once. There's no reason why I can't do it again in, like, a different orientation. Yeah, that's just not helping. Yeah, so that's really the thing, is there's only one horizontal row here at all. And that's clearly a very important puzzle element. Also, I still really don't know why these are here, but I guess we'll figure it out. So one does, of course, have to wonder who set this up in the first place. Was it Delvon's mother who built this? It's hard to say. It could just be a complete red herring. Maybe this place was just naturally built by scholars. I don't know. I mean, that was actually pretty good. If I can just get another extra move here, maybe. Then kind of sneak around like that. But it's not fast enough, that's the thing. Go up here and then sneak down this way or something. Then go across. That's just getting kind of wacky. And then, yeah, if I could somehow get the mimic here and the movement order were correct, which it wouldn't be, but you get the idea. There's possibilities here, but it's all very particular. Yeah. So, once again, I guess I should just check the starting movement order. Yeah, once again, it's pretty weird, because now 2 and 3 are down here, and 4 and 5 are up there. I mean, it doesn't really seem to be standardized per room, like, as far as, like, an up, like, northwest, northeast, southwest, southeast kind of thing. No, it just seems to be per room. So, I mean, that's fine. I mean, there's nothing that's particularly, what's the word? Like, there's nothing orientation-dependent about any of these solutions. It's just movement-dependent. So it's just gonna, like, because of the way that the movement order is mixed up, I might have to do particular movements to kind of reshuffle them, which might be relevant in this kind of a limited motion kind of thing. But it's still not really that much of a problem. Like, I should be able to work this out any which way. It's just a matter of actually getting it to happen. And yeah, this is the real issue is just trying to, like, you have to make moves like that in order to actually preserve your leverage, otherwise you just don't have any leverage anymore. Like, that's actually pretty good. Can I work with this and kind of bring everything up in a kind of a different way? Like, yeah, actually these are the kinds of movements I should be making. Just don't even go all the way up into here, just stick near the center. Yeah, that's a better idea. Yeah, there we go. I knew that something like this would happen if I just fiddled around for a while. I mean, you say not to fiddle, but it will happen. The fiddling will happen whether you want to or not. Alright, I think we got time for one more room. Or at least enough time to take a look at it. Okay. Alright. Sure. Yeah, that's definitely a thing that's gonna happen one day. Oh, and it's gonna follow him too, of course, naturally. Because, you know, our poor citizen, do these even... No, those are just yellow doors. They just look weird. It's hard to... Yeah, they just look weird, but they're yellow doors. It's... There's nothing weird going on here. Let's see. Now, the way that builders work is kind of weird because it takes them one turn to lose track of their relay station. So, like, this might be another situation where using a brained roach might be a bit better. Just because, again, a brained roach doesn't have that weird delay to it. If you can make appropriate brained paths out of these four squares, then the roach will immediately change direction when you hit a button, which just feels more natural. You don't have that going for it. Let's see. So I need to... I kind of want these to kind of... Yeah, go like that. Go one square more horizontal. Then I want them to kind of go more vertical again, like that. And then they'll kind of join up naturally like that. So that's how that happened. Alright, so Beethro's goal of, opening up all the Conquer tokens is actually proceeding pretty well on schedule. Oh, what's this? This is movement order once again. Alright, well, you're gonna need perfect movement order for this. You would want something like this moves up there, that moves over there, this, and then, like, this one and this one move later so they kind of come in. So, yeah, these are the ones that are moving first, so you don't want that. You want them to be more up front. So you want something like that, then. Then go over here and then make this happen somehow. Okay, so what have we got? We've got one, two. That's not quite right. Maybe I want to go around the other way. So that. I mean, this one is certainly not going to happen without any kind of particular, again, movement order. Let's see, what does this one look like? Maybe this one's better. Three, number two. Like, okay, so... Yeah, I would want this one to go, and then that one, and then that one. So, let's see, but this one would go first, and we actually don't want that. Yeah, so this shape... actually, that's a really important thing, is I'm just, like, trying to look at particular shapes. There's only so many shapes you can make. So if I can rule out an entire class of shapes, that helps a lot. Like, shapes that won't work no matter what movement order four puffs is in that shape. So this one won't work. And it probably won't work if it's rotated either. So if, in this case, what would I want? Well, I'd want it to move something like this... Then that happened because this one moved first, and these two are just moving on this horizontal line, so this one moved first, and then it blocked that one. Okay, so that's how that one worked. Alright, I mean, sure, you can form strategies for these things, or, sometimes it'll just happen by accident. So that's most of this place cleared out. So I guess next time we're gonna go, go to this one, and, explore the innermost, secrets of the Crystal Sanctuary. See you then.